to no Form K. I'm still endorsed, but you don't have to because there's three. Three others, yeah. It's the 28th of August. 8/28/17. I think he's just working.
So apparently we're gonna find the models to do this, right?
If you wanna revise subdivision control law, I'm your guest.
I could stand professional. You can send some sort of document, right? Has some smart signature on it.
I'll get right on that. They want like the Mylar also.
That's fine.
By everybody?
Not by.
Okay, that's fine. As long, we just need three.
I notice is hereby given that under Mass General Law, Chapter 48, Section 11, and Section 10.5.11.2(3) of the Reading zoning bylaw, the Community Planning and Development Commission, CPDC, will hold a public hearing on Monday, February 27th, 2017, at 7:30 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Reading Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street.
Did I give you the wrong one?
Oh, this is the original.
Oh, yeah. Right, that's right.
This was the original notification of the hearing. To consider an application for plan approval under Mass General Law Chapter 40R, submitted by 136 Haven Street, LLC, for property located at 136 Haven Street and 0 Sanborn Street, Assessors Map 16, Lot 380, and Assessors Map 21, Lots 33 and 34. A copy of the application and associated plans are available to the public in the Public Services Office in Town Hall, Monday to Thursday from 7:30 a.m. to 5 p.m., and Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m.
Okay, so are there any town staff comments before we start? Julie, do you have any comments before we start the presentation?
No.
Okay, then we'll have a presentation by the applicant, then we'll take some comments from the board, and then.
Thank you. We're very happy to be here after appearing before you and by myself probably 5 or 6 times for continuances. We finally have arrived at that point. I'd like to identify certain people who are in the audience that will be making certain comments as we go along. Tom Connery, sitting in the front. Paul DiBiase, sitting there. Next to Paul is his son, Ugo, and his daughter, Deandra, sitting next to him. David O'Sullivan, you know very well, sitting in the far end there. And Scott Cameron, professional engineer, will be presenting the civil engineering parts of the proposal. Head on. Second slide.
Yes.
Sorry. The owner of the property and the applicant before you is 136 Haven Street, LLC, which is a Massachusetts limited liability company. It is the owner of the property in question. The members of that are Paul and Tom, who are here this evening. The plan is before you is an effort to preserve the historic structure in the front of the site, as well as establishing certain features behind it. And part of the effort here is to preserve the exterior facade, the curved stairway, and flagpole and certain landscaping, which I think are very attractive features of this property. The existing Haven Street driveway will be preserved in its approximate current location. It will be the only vehicular entrance and exit to and from that site, which I think enhances the control of flow of traffic. Currently, there's a driveway off of Sanborn Street that's was used by the postal vehicles. That will be closed off. We do ask as a matter of procedure that the application and supplemental materials that we delivered to you in the past be considered part of our presentation, so they are introduced into evidence as part of the process goes. And we'd like to follow the normal procedure where our three speakers finish their remarks. We answer any questions you have at that point. One of the proposals does involve an outdoor cafe, and that'd be the next slide, if you would. Outdoor cafe on parking. There's parking on site of 72 spaces, 50 spaces are within a garage, and 22 spaces are surface parking. That exceeds the zoning requirement of 1.25 spaces for each dwelling unit. It also will have the handicap parking in accordance with the Architectural Access Board requirements. And a bike parking is also proposed. This will also expand the affordable housing opportunity in the town, as 20% of the units, that is 10 units, will be affordable. The property will be imposed with a restrictive covenant, regulatory agreement, and the master deed and the condominium documents will reference that. If the town wishes, up to 70% of those affordables can be local preference. We leave that up to the commission's decision in that regard. This provides transportation choices. It is a perfect example of smart growth. It's right near the train station, so within a 3-minute walking distance. And with the bicycle facilities, our hope is that there'd be Walkabout Town, which of course is a group in town. This would be supportive of their endeavors to have people walk when they can for their own well-being. It also provides and creates commercial opportunities for the downtown area, which will attract businesses and jobs and also consumers for the existing businesses in the town itself. The on-site drainage controls would comply with the Mass Department of Environmental Protection stormwater management policies. And as I said earlier, the Sanborn Street opening would be eliminated. I'd like to also, as a side note, talk about economic benefits here. We've worked with Andrew Corono, the Economic Development Director, who's guided us along this way, and I'd like to point out certain features here that are really important that may not be really technically part of a site review, and that is that there are going to be significant funds generated for the town's benefit as a consequence of this proposal. Just one-time fees, and that would be the INI fee, which, as you know, is more than just compensating for the sewer added to the system. It actually eliminates certain problems the town already has by payment of significant funds. Also, the building permit and other permit fees would come to over $225,000. So that's a one-time benefit to the town for those applications. In addition, we project, and it's merely a projection, that the annual tax revenue would be $225,000. That should be $450,000. That's each year, $450,000. And on top of that, auto excise tax are probably about $6,000. So there clearly is a benefit to be derived from this. And as I say, the intangible benefit, but it is a real benefit for other businesses, is the fact that there will be consumers helping to support the downtown business community. And as far as employment goes, there will be short-term employment of maybe 100 or so employees in the construction phase, long-term employment, depending on the nature of the uses that go into the site, between 45 and 65 individuals. Now listen for the other side of the equation. Will there be a detriment to the town economically? This has 15 one-bedroom units and 35 two-bedroom units. In a downtown environment, units of that size and configuration are not going to generate school-age children. So there's no real negative impact here. There's a real positive net benefit to the town as a consequence of this project. I'd like to go on to the next slide, and this just identifies who the participants are, and the next slide if we could. I will say that all of the individuals that are involved in this project, I've come to know them. They are professionals who have the best interest of the town at heart, starting with Tom, Matrix Property Group. Tom has extensive experience in the development industry and property management businesses. He's a Reading resident. He's got four sons who have gone through the Reading school system. He's been very active in civic affairs in town. He really cares about our town, and I think that he would certainly want to make sure that this is a project that he'd be proud of and that the town would be proud of as well. And you can see from that, from the slide, the nature of his experience. DiBiase Homes. This is Paul's company, and actually this is a third generation. His father and uncle started this. Paul then took over the business, and now, as I introduced you, his two children are also involved. And frankly, a business that's existed for 60 years in development in real estate has got to do things right to survive. People come back and repurchase. An excellent reputation for quality homes. And you can see there from the slide his experience in that. And this plan shows the locations. We have Beverly, Swampscott, Wakefield, Linfield, just to name a few that Paul's company has been involved in. There's extensive experience here. Going on to David O'Sullivan, he is an architectural firm in Reading, also a Reading resident, long time. He's appeared before you many times. I know his work. I have other clients that use him all the time because of the quality of what he produces. And so you can see his experience, and I think you know his experience. He also has, working in his firm, a young man that graduates from Reading High School and Syracuse University, who's an architect in training, who works on him. So he's also supporting the local community. Next is Scott Cameron's company, Warren Cameron Group. I've got to know Scott during this process. He's very quick, understands very well his profession, and he's very professional in the way he does things. So I look forward to his presentation to you this evening. We move on to the aerial. This is just that you obviously know this location, but the objective here is to orient you as far as the property is concerned. If I can, without blinding anybody, use a laser here. So we have, I guess that's purple, right? I'm kind of colorblind.
Yes.
Okay, so that's purple. That's the facility right there. And then this is Sanborn Street, Haven Street, Linden Street, in those vicinities. I think one thing that's very beneficial here is that the street layout, the street controls are already in place. In other words, Haven Street is one way down, Sanborn Street is one way from Woburn, Linden Street is one way in the opposite direction. So it has an excellent traffic flow. If someone's going to this location, they're going to come off Main, go down Haven, and into the driveway. And they'll leave in that location. So the residences, people who are living in this facility, have no reason to go other areas through the residential portions of town. If one is going to be heading west, they're going to go down Haven, then high to Woburn Street, or possibly going south, they'll go south down to intersect Washington with Main Street and head down to 128 and 95 in that direction. So it's going to have little abutting impact, and it's excellent traffic flow and good sight distance in that area as well. The primary residential access will be off of Sanborn Street for people who are walking in, either the visit or otherwise. People who live there would probably simply drive into the driveway and go into the underground garage or the outside garage and walk inside through a different way into their unit. This just shows a different aspect of it. The front portion, by front I mean nearest Haven Street, is the historic section. The area in back is simply an addition that was put on in the 60s. It's really a warehouse in appearance with loading docks. I think we submitted to you some photographs back in the days when the post office was active here, and that place was laden with postal vehicles, heavy traffic resulting from that. So that has been the historical use of that back area. When the post office sold this property, it imposed a historic covenant on the ownership, which is a high level of control and a high standard, high bar to meet. We have spent 6 months working with the Massachusetts Historical Commission to satisfy them and to the design. There have been changes made to design to the credit of both the Reading Historical Commission and the proponents of working together to work this out so we come to an acceptable design. So we are pleased to say that we have their support now to this project. There were certain changes made as a consequence of that redesign. The number of units went from 55, which was in the original application to you. The supplemental application showed 50 units. So that was one reduction as a direct consequence of those discussions. The parking ratios change was 1.33, it's now 1.44. Both of those exceeded the town standards, but nevertheless, it's even better. Excuse me. The size of the building itself has been reduced by 7,500 square feet. And the new building, which originally was over a portion of the historic portion of the post office building, has now been moved back some distance. So it's actually the new addition is 143 feet back from Haven Street sidewalks. That's a very large setback. And 98 feet from the historic facade of the post office. And as you see from some of the renderings, and David will go through with you, you're actually standing on Haven Street, can't even see this addition, maybe a little sliver at the very top. Now, when we went through the analytical part of this, and this is why this coloring is here, we asked the question, what is the relevance of a historic restriction, and what could do violence to that, or what should be allowed by that? And we came up with three standards. The first was, one must determine the viewpoint from which you can see the historic structure. Because if you can't see the historic structure, then what you add to it is not material to its historical significance. And that yellow area there shows the locations that one can see the actual historic building. So the second step was to determine what you do will have an impact on the public view from those crucial locations. So the redesign had that standard in mind, and in essence has minimized the impact from those vantage points. And the last determination was whether or not what's being proposed would be substantially detrimental to the historic purpose, historic covenant, And the Mass Historical Commission, would please just say, the Reading Historical Commission, came to the conclusion that does not substantially detrimental. And that's why we're able to appear before you today, and that's why we went through the long process. I'd like to close with a couple of remarks on traffic. There has been a transportation impact assessment, and if you look at the volume that was there when the post office were there, what this proposal does is reduce that traffic by 82%. In addition, I think it's important that we are in close proximity to public transportation. So the feeling is that many people who buy in this facility will probably commute, will use the train to work. Or, again, there is bus service in downtown Reading as well. So there is encouragement by the location of this to take advantage of public transportation. Going to some of the raw numbers, as far as, again, the traffic count was almost 2,000 vehicle trips per day on a weekday when the post office was there. That the project now is 382. We know, of course, the vehicle trip, someone going in is one trip, that person leaving is a second trip. So that's a significant reduction from what was there before. And also, of course, they had trucks all the time when the post office was there. There'd be very few deliveries that would take place here. And I think it's also noteworthy, and I happen to see a University of California study that talks about transit-oriented buildings, which is this kind of a building, this proximity to a public train facility. And their comment was that the vehicle trips generated by this kind of a facility are significantly lower than the Institute of Transportation Engineers trip generation manual. And I think that's the kind of thing that we're going to see here as a consequence of this. So at this point, I'd ask if David would take it from here and comment on the architectural features.
David O'Sullivan from O'Sullivan Architects. This chart here kind of summarizes that the proposed buildings for 50 units, as Brad said, down from the original 55. Our FAR has dropped to 1.86. The zone does allow 2.8. We did not try to maximize FAR on this. The building contains about 6,600 square feet of commercial space and about 1,800 of commercial support down in the basement. It contains 15 one-bedrooms and 35 two-bedrooms, and it's four floors with a partial penthouse level on top. As Brad said, it's 144 spaces, 1.44 spaces per residential unit. And it actually, the site actually contains about 29% open space, not including the decks and the balconies. And so right now the site, the whole back is paved. We're actually adding significant open space in the back. On this basement level, we basically take, and this is the vehicle entrance that you now see off of Haven. We're redeveloping the parking lot and keeping it low. That allowed us to come into the lower level of the rear addition of the post office, putting parking there. And essentially where the back parking lot is what we call the residential addition, which has the 50 cars inside. We also have in this area bike parking scattered around, some storage for unit owners. We also have a trash room directly for the unit owners. Under the original post office, we have support spaces for the commercial. We have indoor trash. Utility spaces and some extra commercial space that can serve as storage for them. We also propose a small addition on the front here that is about 1,600 square feet of commercial, allowing us to kind of, as you come along Haven, this reaches grade level here, so you can come into here and enliven this part of the street. Next slide. On the main level, as we said, we're keeping this all steps, etc., keeping kind of the landscaping intact. We have a new stair proposed here. We're going to rebuild the handicap ramp. And this gets us up to the main level of the post office, where there'll be a large commercial space and a separate smaller space that's part of the 69 addition. We We will be putting a little piece of walkway across here to kind of connect the entrances, to kind of create continuous flow from down here on Haven up through the steps all the way over and out the other side. On Sanborn Street, we created basically two larger pieces of building with this courtyard in the middle to help break up this facade along Sanborn Street. There are 12 residential units on this floor and an amenity space for the development. The building's served by elevator, fire stairs, and we've now provided kind of this green buffer around the sides of the building where before it was paved right up to the edge. The building height along Sanborn Street is essentially from Sanborn Street sidewalk up to our first step back is 36 feet, and then going up to the next level, which is the fourth floor, is 49, and then we have the penthouse that's set back further, and that from the street grade is 56. One of the things that is a consequence of working with the existing building and working with this, the floor level of the old post office is actually about 2.5 feet above Sanborn Street over here. So we have a ramp to come up that we integrated into the courtyard so it's not obvious. But to reuse the parking underneath in the garage, we had to raise this floor up, which kind of brings it up higher than a couple feet higher than if you were just coming right off of grade. And that was kind of a function of the existing building and what we were dealing with on site for grading. So, that has an effect on our height of the building. And then the site dropping from a high point over here to a low point over there creates kind of an average grade around the building that's lower. And the way the zoning reads, that kind of hurts us when you kind of look at what the actual number that they, under the zoning definition. So the height of the building isn't as tall as it appears on one number there that comes across on the application. Next slide. The second floor, due to the nature of this post office, the original building is kind of a story and a half, and to get floor levels to align and keep the overall height of the building down, we basically have this piece of the addition that contains only 9 units, and there's no construction over either the 69 addition or the original post office. Going up to the next slide, the third floor, we're back up to 12 units, all residential. There is the elevator and stairs serving everything. Several of the units have outside balconies that help give them outdoor space and help break up the facade. We also have these 3 units that are built over the 1969 kind of warehouse addition. This dark line shows you where our original 55 unit footprint was. So you can see the significant reduction that happened during the process with the Reading Historic and Massachusetts. Next slide. The fourth floor very much mimics the third, except we have some setbacks here and a couple of corners that are cut away. So that gets you up to that, was that 36 feet there, then steps back. We thought it was important along Sanborn to keep the building back lower. We have a little lower piece here as well, where that has the most impact where people are walking along the side. So we did the step backs there. Moving up to our penthouse level, this penthouse level is set back kind of in all sides of the building, and now is back from Haven Street, 140 feet. So the dark lines are the former penthouse that we had. The former penthouse came out an additional kind of 40 feet in front, and it had these corners, and it came out onto Sanborn more. So this penthouse level now has basically 40% of the area of the building footprint. Significantly reduced during the historic review process the size of the penthouse. The penthouse only has 5 units instead of 7. And we think this basically helps keep the predominance of the historic building and make this top floor less visible and less of an impact on the people walking around, the people in the neighborhood. It is important to have this level. feel, because of his homeownership, the kind of cachet of having a penthouse level and being able to have people live up there and have their roof have some terraces, et cetera, I think is very important to both the feel of the building, the attitude of the building, and the economic viability. The site plan, this is basically what Brad had shown you before, where you can view the purple being the original building, the white being the 69 addition. This back little piece, which is the old loading dock, is going to be torn off the building. There's no basement underneath it. It was originally open and was closed at some point. This is basically a picture that shows the original building and our proposed building with the courtyard on Sanborn Street. Rendering on the right is standing pretty much in front of the Eastern Bank building. You're kind of out there, and you can see that the rear addition is barely visible up in there, back behind, set back. The Sonic Hall kind of overwhelms the street. This small piece here is our kind of commercial addition we talked about, and we're utilizing the rooftop of that for outdoor dining. The slide over here shows the building, and you can kind of see the penthouse. We pulled it in substantially from Sanborn and obviously pulled in from Haven, that 140 some odd feet. And then you can kind of catch the edge of the rooftop space. This space on top of the little one-story addition we think will serve well with hopefully getting a restaurant tenant. So this corner is standing on the corner of Haven and Sanborn. We are keeping the windows, etc., in the original 1918. This addition over here, we really wanted to open up the corner, try to comply more with the 40R, where we have that flexibility and we aren't under a historic covenant. We're basically putting lots of glass in this corner, making it more dominant, more active, putting some additional glass along the sides. You can see the addition here, and you kind of peek into the courtyard there. The other rendering is standing kind of in front of Subway and looking at down the corner. The new addition set back over 100 feet, and it's only over the 1969 addition, nothing over the 1918. The building itself, we're trying to kind of keep the windows that are similar in character to the original post office, changing materials in the sense that we want to distinctly show that this is an addition, it's not part of that. Following the Secretary of State standards that you don't want an addition, you want the addition to be distinguishable from the original historic structure. Next. All right, this is standing back up by the Congregational Church, looking down. As you can see that the buildings on Woburn and then the parking lot that was the old Reading Co-op parking lot and then our building here. This is probably the place you see the building largest, but it doesn't seem to impose anything, and you can kind of see the three steps off of Sanborn Street. The other view is standing at the corner of Linden and Woburn Street, and you can see the new addition peeking out between the two older residences that are there. Next. So the slide on this side is more of a detail. We plan on kind of retaining the existing historic granite wall, cutting into it to get some better access to the retail space, trying to utilize materials that would be matching the wall or similar to the wall. Putting a little bit better handicap ramp that's there, and landscaping along. corner of Sandborn. You can see the addition again sticking in the background. The other view here, this is our residential entry courtyard coming off of Sandborn, where you come up some steps or come around through this ramp that works its way through the courtyard. This is the landscape courtyard. It serves as a nice spot for the residents and for other people as a break, and landscaping and then setting the building back helps basically to make the building kind of broken into two parts. And basically the materials here, we're using masonry on the bottom. We're using some brick accents to kind of tie into the brick of this. Windows that are similar to the windows in the front of the post office. Doing a contemporary cornice, but basically capping the building with a very strong cornice, similar to what's there. Different style, but kind of a modern interpretation of it. Next for landscaping. So this is our proposed landscaping plan. As we talked about, there's basically lawn areas around the sides of the building in the back. This is our closest residential abutter. This is the apartment the Knights of Columbus, and then these are multifamily buildings. There are some trees along here that are planted in the edge of the parking lot here, so we didn't try to replicate more trees there. There's not a lot of space, and those trees need space to grow. This is kind of our highlight of the Sanborn Street experience as you drive. We'll walk along with our landscape courtyard and open area for gathering. Talked about that. The landscape in front of the building will basically be, you know, the old overgrown stuff will be taken out, will be enhanced. This is our little courtyard, our little patio that is off of the commercial space, and then of course the rooftop piece here. For the parking lot, we'll have some new trees and some landscaping along the edge. As far as street trees go, we haven't really documented them. There are some street trees there. There's some damage, there's some empty places in the sidewalks where there were street trees. We'll work with the town, assess their condition, assess where it makes sense to add street trees, and work with them on what kind of improvements could happen for that trees. Now to lighting. This is our lighting plan, photometrics. We have some low-level lighting in the courtyard. We want to light the handicap ramp here. We have lighting along the edge here for the signage. The front, we're going to retain the two historic light fixtures, which tend to not really match standards of today, but we'll see what we can do to relamp them or put on some shields so they aren't all shining straight up. We're putting some lighting in the parking lot here. We do have a little spillover of light onto the Sanborn Street sidewalk, which we actually think is beneficial because the street light there, the street light way down here, this isn't a real brightly lit corner, and we do want to make sure that it's lit up for residents and for safety concerns. Parking lot itself we have here does have a little spillover onto the blank wall of the Masonic Temple, which is because of our location of light fixtures. We have cutoff fixtures, we have dark sky fixtures, but there's a little spillover, very minor spillover there, which we don't think is a real issue from any of the neighbors. On the residential end up here, there are no lighting proposed. And I guess the last is, what this is a short video we produced. You start at Sanborn Street, and basically walks you around the site, so that gives you an idea. This is the first thing is the parking lot for the Reading Coop, or that's now something else. And these are some suggestions of what the street trees could be along here. You can see into the courtyard as you go by the side of the building. This is the residential portion of the addition, then the corner that we talked about with the ramp coming around. And as you come around, you see that the addition kind of disappears. two-story piece there. And then as you kind of fade away and move farther from it, you start to get a view of the additions. Yeah, I'll turn it over to Scott to talk about more of the technical aspects for engineering and utilities, et cetera.
Thanks, David. Good evening. For the record, my name is Scott Cameron. I'm a principal owner and registered professional civil engineer with the Moore and Cameron Group. We have a principal place of business at 66 Elm Street in Danvers, Massachusetts. Tom Paul, we're gracious enough to have me onto the team here. I think a lot of it was based on the countless multifamily projects we've been involved with over the years. I've been practicing for about 15 years. And what I'd like to do tonight is walk you through the civil engineering technical plans as best I can follow up that act by David. Don't have a video. I'll try to keep it as interesting as possible. So if we could skip right to our existing conditions. So the way we kind of build our projects is we start obviously with what's on the ground today. And so we conducted a detailed topographic survey and a boundary survey of the site. If you have, I'm going to presume most of you are familiar with this location at this point in time. But what you see is more or less what you have on the property. I'll try to highlight some of the more interesting characteristics of it. Sanborn Street, you can see here, followed by Haven Street. There is the curb cut. We drive down into the site, and this is more or less level. It's a couple feet below Sanborn, and then you drive down, and you can exit out onto Haven. There's about a 10-foot grade differential from Haven up to Sanborn in that corner. So we're talking about the height of the building and the grades, and there's about a story change in grade from one corner to the other on the site. We did do extensive utility research. We found plenty of information on the street. The infrastructure is mapped out on the plan. We found nothing on the site itself, so that required a little more investigation on our part, specifically with regard to what's happening with the stormwater runoff and the stormwater on the site, because we could see it all there, we just couldn't see where it was going. So we did a series of interior and exterior inspections. We videoed as many pipes as we could get into. We actually excavated a test hole in one area to figure out kind of a questionable area we're trying to determine, and we did some dye testing. And what we concluded was, obviously the original 1918 building here, being the oldest, that is actually the roof and the floor drains and the portion of the driveway on this side all run off to the surface of Haven Street here. In fact, a very unique feature of this is that on the curb line, if you walk down, I know you probably can't see that picture too well, there's actually a break in the curb and a little 4 to 6 inch high by 12 inch wide box. And that's actually the outlet for that portion of the site. So the building and that portion of the site runoff. And when they did the addition in the late 60s, you could also tell that there was an apparent effort to keep the water contained on the site and not to disperse it out onto the other properties. And what we discovered through dye testing, the video testing, is that there's a series of small dry wells, one here, and one here, that collect the runoff from the newer addition of the site in the rear parking area. So what you have, and then wrapping the site, is a retaining wall, which keeps everything contained on. So what you have is a portion of the site directly discharging out onto the street in the public way, into the gutter line. And you have a portion of the site that's being infiltrated. We have soil boring information in our test hall. There's sand and gravel on the property, so very well-drained soil. And there's also some bedrock we encountered. So you have a little bit of everything going on. Now, you know, I want to pay attention to this corner of the site as we go through the plans here. I'll note finally, there were, you know, the property serviced by gas, electric, water, sewer. Everything's coming in. The electric is coming in on this corner of the building. That's going to be removed. If you can move on to the next plan. So as we build our plan set, the next phase was looking at, well, how are we going to build the project? And the first thing we have to do is start doing some demolition and getting the site ready. The second plan here is detailing some of the work that will be involved with that initial setup. So what I did, I just highlighted in beige the existing building. This yellow is the footprint of the proposed addition, approximately. And this plan identifies, you know, where are we going to remove curb, what are we going to stack, retain, reset in places, utilities coming out. And I also highlighted in red here a portion of Sanborn Street and then coming down along Haven, where it's actually out into the street. We have a zero setback, building setback here, which is what you're looking for to build that street line. But as you can imagine, we have to excavate right up to and beyond the property line in order to put that foundation in. So we're going to have to temporarily shut down a portion of the sidewalk to build that building. And what this plan identifies is rerouting pedestrian routes. So we'll put in a temporary crosswalk here. We'll bring them down the sidewalk on the other side of Haven, and then we will maintain the sidewalk and fill in the vacant tree wells so that you have a uniform width accessible route going around the site. And of course, there will be construction fencing to provide security to make sure nobody can get into the property where they're not supposed to be interfacing. This plan also identifies areas where we're going to install erosion controls on existing catch basins or other features for that aspect of the project. If you would not mind moving to the next slide. So this is our site layout plan. Our objectives here, we're focused on maximizing the parking for the facility. We know that was an important aspect of the project, but we also wanted to minimize the amount of asphalt and pavement on the project. And as a consequence, the majority of the parking fell underneath the building here. There's 50 parking spaces here, 2 handicap spaces, which are located right here. And then we have the remaining 22 surface spaces on the side of the building here. And what's unique about these is we did design them to incorporate some pervious area on portions of the parking spaces. So where you have a kind of a portion of the car that would pull in normally and the wheels would hit the bumper, we're making that last bit of the parking space grass. So you're taking advantage of that overhang on the car, which you don't need to have asphalt. We minimized the aisle width to 23 feet. And we're doing all this exceeding the parking ratio, and we're providing the handicap parking space right here. In addition, we're adding in the street trees to the parking area, so we broke in some islands, so we don't have a big sheet of asphalt, and it's really not that wide. And you'll see it on the grading plan, which is the next sheet. This whole area is going to be tucked in, where now, as you come to the site, you go up, and you're above all the adjacent properties. Well, we're going to excavate down so we can get into the garage, so now, when this is built, you'll actually be down below the adjacent properties. So this will be basically an earthen buffer against any headlights or impacts, et cetera, to those properties. In particular, you'll have about a 6-foot cut along the edge here where you'll be below these properties. The circulation, I won't cover the rest of it on the building. I think David hit all that sufficiently. I will note the usable open spaces extend up around the perimeter of the building, which will be a series of patios and green areas. And then you see above the garage, it's not on this plan to clear, but your courtyard is actually above the garage right here, and that's your pedestrian access off of Sanborn. Okay, we can go to the next slide. So when we got into the stormwater management aspect of the project, this is probably the bulk of our work, and after a very thorough investigation of existing conditions, our main task was to make sure we improve upon that condition. The project is a slight reduction in impervious surface. Most notably is it a huge swap from pavement impervious surface to building. So roof runoff isn't going to contain a lot of the contaminants that you'd find in a parking lot that come off of cars. So we look at the roof runoff as mostly clean as compared to the parking. And our parking area is really limited to this space right here. So what are we doing? We're adding in pretreatment measures where none exist today. So there will be a proprietary hydrodynamic separator, which is going to process and separate out a lot of the sand and grit, which contain a lot of your pollutants. This would meet the state standard, the Mass DEP standard for renovation of the stormwater. And then we're designing a subsurface recharge system, or an infiltration system. And this is going to mimic what's going on today with the drywells on site. In fact, what we're doing with this is we're making it a larger footprint area than what's there now. So we're actually going to get more recharge of the groundwater or of the storm runoff into the ground than what's happening now. Right now you have very small diameter drywall, so you get a vertical cone, and the way we get water into the ground is spreading it out. So that's what we're attempting to do here. So we have a wider, flatter recharge system. We're really going to maximize the site's ability to recharge the stormwater runoff. There would be also a connection into the municipal storm sewer. So we're going to eliminate that condition where you have water sheeting off directly into the street. This will improve any icing conditions that are probably experienced there, both in the street, the parking spaces. If you step out of the passenger door, you're stepping right into the flow line of the gutter. So you're going to be a vast improvement here. And as I mentioned, whereas now this entire side of the property drains down onto the street, Now it's going to go the other direction, so we're going to reverse that. Water's going to come down to a low spot here before climbing back up to the garage. So this will all be below the grade of the adjacent properties. It'll be about even here, and then it'll be about a foot or two above right there, whereas it's going to be about the same on the corner, which we're going right back in to match the existing conditions. We're retaining the majority of the existing granite wall that you saw on the front here. Portions will be just more of a screening wall when they're done, because we're taking the soil out behind it, and that will all remain in place. And then if you could go to the last plan. This is just our utility plan. At this phase of the process, you know, we haven't gotten into full building mechanical systems and designs yet, but what we do know is we're going to have a grease tank for a potential restaurant use in the property. We'll have a sand, gas, and oil separator for the garage drainage. You'll have your stormwater management, new sewer for the regular sanitary, new water, new fire, all new utilities. And we hope to bring in the electrical and the communications to a new transformer, which again, we're going to tuck into this corner. So it should be relatively out of sight and not visible to the general public. The access into the garage, you can see, again, there's a landscape island right here. We're trying to screen that whole corner and keep that kind of utilitarian portion in an area that you won't be able to see it from the street. I think that's all I have. No video, sorry. I have the sewer videos if you're interested. I can bring them.
That concludes our direct presentation. I'd be more than happy to answer any questions at the commission. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Well, you certainly did the best you could with the time you had, that's for sure. It was a good presentation. I thought you added a lot of information we were looking for from the earlier scheme we started seeing. Julie, is there anything from engineering? Comments or questions from the board?
Well, the simple comment is I like it.
Thank you.
Job well done.
I would reiterate that.
Yeah, I like the architectural changes you made from the early schemes, which look like just about every other housing project that's going up right now. This has got a little more flair to it that it looks like it belongs. I'm just going to stick with that for a second. You show a lot of bands and a lot of relief in those bands in that material. That's really important for this building, so I don't want to see that value engineered out. You're showing relief, you're showing caps. Some of the other buildings don't have that, and that really impacts the scale of it and the feel and the quality of it. You show something that looks like stone on the sandborne side. Can you tell me what you think that is?
What we're looking at is probably a man-made masonry, kind of a sandstone look, feel to kind of mimic what's on the front trim of the post office.
Okay, so but not like a CMU.
It's not a CMU. No.
All right. So a CMU would be something like you see on top of Walgreens that they was supposed to be stone, but ended up being CMU.
No, we're looking at something that's more of kind of a sandstone.
As far as the street trees go, if you really are going to investigate where they end up, I would consider maybe not just putting them back in the same hole if that hole is going to block something you're doing for the commercial areas. A lot of the downtown businesses have a tree right in front of their sign. The trees were there first, so if we have a choice, maybe we can figure out where those go.
I also wanted to thank you for the rendering the view from the First Baptist and the street behind there, because that's an important factor. This is going to be a large addition to the neighborhood.
Yeah, the one view we don't really have is from the first residence right after the Verizon building on Linden. So they get the tall corner and they get the shadows. They're to the northwest corner. I know you're stepping it back, you know, at several penthouse is stepped back, and actually it looks like the balcony for the penthouse is even stepped back. Yeah, I don't think you went down Linden, but...
If I may, Mr. Chairman, I think that in response to Dave's comment, which is right on, we actually had to find locations where this could be seen more clearly. Because it's actually blocked. If you're on the level of Woburn Street, say in front of what was the Nigro building, you can't see it. So that it is obstructed in many areas. So when Dave went out, the staff went out and took pictures, they had to pick certain vantage points we could see something. Right. Now that's a positive feature.
We also did some views. It will peek out from the CVS parking lot. You'll kind of see it between the Reading Co-op Bank and the Knights of Columbus a little bit. We didn't do a rendering there. We kind of saw that.
Yeah, I don't mind seeing the building. It's not a one-story building.
We tried not to have it over by. I think that probably the residents, the two corner residents on Linden are probably, as you say, the ones that have got the...
Actually, it's that first residence on the right. So the corner of their property, I think,
is abutting us.
Below, right?
And it's about 8 feet below us.
So they're getting the brunt of it.
They're getting it. That we try to, that corner is carved back in plan, and then it's carved as it goes up farther too.
Right.
So there's two spots on the property that abut residential, that little corner for that. And then when they rezoned the former house to a parking lot, Reading Co-op, they left 15 foot, half the width of the street is residential still, so the residential comes across the parking lot, down the front of the parking lot, back to the center line of Sanborn and back up. It's a really quirky zoning map thing, which is actually where we are. We asked for a waiver of down to 13.5 feet. That's that corner there. We're actually compliant where we're next to the house for the zoning. But the other one is the odd one that we didn't even realize existed until we did a little more investigation. The old zoning line went to the center line of Sanborn for residential, and they rezoned the lot. They never included the piece of Sanborn in front.
Never happened.
Oh yeah.
Not on my watch.
Well, that was interesting development.
As far as traffic goes, I understand that you took the numbers based on what the post office was doing. But when was the last time the post office was used?
A year ago.
They were there probably a year ago. They moved across the street.
Trucks, were they fully operating out of that space?
Well, to that volume?
Yeah.
Probably 5 years ago when they started the consolidating.
Okay. The only concern I would have, and it looks like it's addressed because you have a low-grade corner, is the entrance into Haven from the Haven Street side. You've got the handicap parking right there, and it looks like you striped the street side of that, which is good because it pushes the car further back from the sidewalk. So entering and exiting from there with pedestrians coming up and down the sidewalk. I want to make sure there's no landscaping, no retaining walls that block that sight line.
There's actually presently, I mean, even though you're coming down now, I've been parking in the parking lot for the last 2 months. Because I work downtown, I don't always have a parking space. And my client's been nice to me. But I've been going in and out of that entrance, and it's not too bad. I mean, it's kind of some of the people are surprised to see somebody coming in and out of there. But
the other aspect, too, is that you have the parking spaces on the street on that corner, which pushes the traffic another 8 feet out. So where you're actually turning in is another 8 to 9 feet further away from the curb line and sidewalk.
So you shot some views from Haven Street. There's the one that has the Masonic building in front. Is that critical to Mass Historic's understanding that you're not visible from the historic piece of the property? Because the Masonic building may not be there, and the new building that goes in that place may be square to the street, parallel to the street. So
if the Masonic building goes away, you'll actually be able to see the kind of left side of the historic post office more. And our building addition is set back beyond the historic building, so I think that from the standpoint of Mass Historic, I think if the Masonic's gone, well, if someone were to do a 40R, pull out zoning, you would have something that might be 3-4 stories right up to the street. And would probably, something new to be redeveloped there would probably have more of an impact on the historic than what our addition does.
Loading space?
We did have a loading space next to the garage entrance and where the trash comes out, so there is a loading space there.
And we think that that's going to be enough with, let's say there's commercial going on, it's the first of the month or the last of the month, and people are moving in, you have one elevator.
The one elevator is fine for this level. You want to basically, 50 is about the break even for two elevators. But we do have some ground floor. We have 12 units on the ground floor, so you're really, those wouldn't be utilizing it. We anticipate that probably a moving truck is going to go in and out through the residential entry and would probably have to take away a couple of the parallel spaces along Sanborn Street. I would expect the residential move-out and move-ins would be that. And we are condominiums, so there won't be as often as if it was a year-to-year rental lease. But the most efficient way for moving trucks is that. We assume that the restaurant and retail services will come in from the Sanborn Street, Haven Street parking lot, and there is a loading space there provided.
I just have two more. One is to do with your sidewalk closure during construction. Are you actually going onto the street as well, or just the sidewalk? Because there's a lot of parking there for the drop-off and pick-up for the dance studio. You got small kids coming out.
Sanborn, probably just the sidewalk.
You're just closing the sidewalk, or do you need to take the street as well?
It's pretty much just a sidewalk and maybe a foot or two into the street. So we're the way I have it noted on the plan is to maintain the 20-foot width for fire access, which is more than enough for a car to park on the side and another car to still get around it.
And then as far as bedrock goes, you better plan for that, because if you get a waiver from the height, the building's not getting taller. So if you find a bunch of bedrock in the middle of your parking garage, you better start taking it out.
Well, in reality, we can't really change. We're so locked in by the existing post office grade and the post office heights of floors, we have to dig it out. We run into it, we have to dig it out. We can't really change. It's too integral into the existing structure.
All right, just don't underestimate it.
Any grade changes.
It was around 13 feet down, so we encountered it, but it was a little
and
deeper.
We're about 10 feet down at the lowest, so we think we miss it all. But
all right, good.
That rear portion, too, just the history, those used to be two single-family dwellings before the post office put the parking lot and the addition back there. So we know there was houses and foundations there at one point in time to excavate down. So.
Okay, thank you.
So the handicap spot that you're taking out of commission should be relocated somewhere
else
while it's out. There's a good amount of parking disruption and sidewalk disruption going on here. What is the plan to deal with materials delivery, contractor parking, and a lot of just trade that's going to flood this building while it's in construction? Every guy wants a parking spot.
So to answer the first part of your question regarding the handicap spot, my proposal on here is to, if you could bring open C2, is just to relocate that right around the corner, and we'll move the sign and put that right there, because you'll still see some of the striping sticking out from the fence, and I wanted to black that out and make sure that somebody didn't even think that was a handicapped spot. So you can see right here. So I wanted to move it from that spot to that spot. And regarding, you know, construction staging equipment, obviously there's not a lot of area on this site to stockpile. So there will probably be small stockpiles of just day-to-day materials like your gravel, sand, and those will be in really the only area we can put them here. But as far as any, you know, exports or imports, those will be loaded up and taken off site. You're not going to see large stockpiles on this property. There's just not enough room for it. I imagine the foundation is probably the first thing going in, so that, you know, the majority of the earthwork will occur at the beginning of the project, and then that'll quiet down. The construction entrance will probably be utilizing a portion of this when this is being excavated and worked, but once this is, the foundation's in, this is your entrance to the site here. And you'll have your construction mat, your cleaning mat, all that will be situated right there.
So the idea is not to have multiple trucks stacked up waiting to make deliveries in the middle of the street?
No, they'll have to stagger them to prevent that, yeah.
They can circle like we do when we're looking for parking.
Yeah, no, they won't. They'll just
But contractor parking is a good question. You should figure out where that's going to go so that they're not all holding up the whole parking lot all day.
So we typically, as we get into the process, we'll sit down with applicants and work with them on things like construction parking, and police department is a great resource. They help us with creative ideas, so we definitely can work together to smooth that out.
As we're talking about that sort of stuff, can we, I'd like to explore the loading space and commercial deliveries and how that's going to work. I guess I'm not probably the right, if you can bring up the basement level. Yeah, so, you know, I guess, can trucks really get in and back up into that space there? What size trucks could actually get in there? You know, if you're going to have if the hope is that you have a restaurant, you know, and we all know they have a hard time getting small deliveries in. So
our anticipation is that this is enough for kind of a small box truck. We wouldn't have room for any tractor trailer trucks at all, and that would have to be written into the people's lease as far as what size vehicle could come for deliveries. We do anticipate too that if there's several deliveries at once, we may temporarily block these spaces here, but this still with the 23 aisle width, you can get cars by it. There wouldn't, as much as you think of 50 cars in there as being a lot coming and going, they come and go in the morning and the evening. So, I think that it's not a perfect situation, but we're in a downtown and this seems to work pretty well, I think.
Except, I guess, sure. Except that's really the only place they can deliver to, and that's a constrained area to be able to have that function. Next slide.
Sure, I think part of the problem, of course, is that we are taking the historic building and preserving it. This location on the lot creates a lot of issues, and that's one of those.
Yeah, I guess my thought is that really, I mean, you're going to find out because you have to try and lease that space, but is that really going to end up being a functional restaurant space where someone can actually do a thriving business in there? And I'm questioning that just because of some of those logistics areas.
The other thing we thought about talking to, but right now there's basically about a 30-foot curb cut along Sanborn. Mm-hmm. So there are parallel spaces along here, though they're not marked, and there's a substantial curb cut. And we could talk to the selectmen about maybe taking that 30-foot curb cut and putting that as a loading zone, because that could be a secondary loading to come in, up the ramp and in, and it would also serve well for moving trucks. So basically not impacting the number of spaces downtown, but taking that some area along Sanborn
to be part of
as a secondary loading zone.
Yeah.
Because I think they would want to restripe this spaces along here anyways, and we move the curb cut, we basically got that 30-foot
space,
additional space along the curb that's not parking right now.
Yeah, that's functionally, it's successful even for the oversized trucks that will be there.
I think that was what I was talking about with moving trucks too, would be the ideal spot for moving trucks, because that brings you right up this ramp and into the elevator right here.
Yeah, I mean, our traditional problem is that we're well aware of is the 40-foot trailers in and out of Dunkin' Donuts, where the truck is twice the size of the business that they're serving.
So I'd encourage you to think through that and maybe talk with the selectmen about it so that you do have a plan that works functionally. The other thing that I just notice is that you do have, looking at the same plan, a number of smaller storage areas tucked in behind, tucked in behind parking spaces. I guess I would encourage you to think a little bit more substantially about bike parking. As was noted, if this is supposed to be, TOD focused and the numbers of parking spaces are small, then we hope that bikes get used more and we want you to be able to facilitate
this that. Room was for bike parking and for the thing, and I think there's some spaces, here and some spaces right in here that are islands due to the configuration of that we can put some additional bike racks, which is supposed to be the bike
storage
room kind of thing.
Yeah,
so for long term, but
we have some surface spaces as well that's needed on site.
Right, we have some bike parking up on Sanborn by the bottom of the handicapped ramp for
patrons coming
to there as well.
Yeah, in terms for the residents, I mean, something as simple as the ability for wall walls to be in the parking lot.
Yeah. We anticipated that these would probably go with the space that they're with, that would do it, and these as well.
Right.
So we don't have one for every unit, but a lot of them could have that space, and that was why the supplemental bike parking over there.
But as you noted, I mean, if you use that space on the right there as a bike room, and then you noted,
in those islands. Substantial
islands
in this section because of the inefficiency of the existing structure.
Then you probably have enough space there to make it work.
Yeah. Good.
Anything else? I had one question on the drainage. I just was curious. I note that coming out of the the infiltration vault basin, there's on here there's a note that says proposed outlet control structure. Oh, it says connect to municipal drain extension by others. What's that mean?
You have a good eye. I was smiling because I knew what you were going to ask. So the municipal drainage system, because we bring up sheet C4, I believe, is down at the intersection here. So we have the trunk line goes right through here. There's a 30-inch concrete culvert. I'm meeting with Ryan Percival on Tuesday. We're going to be talking about this a little bit. It will have to be extended up 80th Street, the municipal system. We haven't figured out how that's going to happen, but it needs to happen.
Okay.
So I'll have more information for you on that in the next meeting.
Great.
There's nothing preventing them from cutting into that street. By the time they cut it, it'll be beyond the number of years since we paved it. I know when we finished the downtown, no one was allowed to cut into the street that's by the bank building there. Had to get their utilities in early.
But we didn't go down Haven Street.
Yeah, it's now. They were cutting into it this spring.
I know, you noted and talked about the lighting on the front of the building and around the front of the building. I didn't see any plans for any lighting either, even at the entrance, but I presume there isn't anything on the back side of the building or even at the residential entrance?
The residential entrance has a canopy over it, so we do downlighting in that, and then we're integrating some low-level lighting along that ramp in the wall that's along Sanborn, kind of facing into our site.
No lighting on the balconies?
It will be, it's required by building code actually to have a light at the top. Aim it, something that aims down and not glares out.
Some public comments. If you speak, can you please state your name and your address?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Barry Berman. I'm a member of the Board of Selectmen. I'm just speaking, and just one selectman, so I'm not obviously speaking to the board. Tom and Paul, I really want to commend you on this presentation and you and your team. This is a far cry better proposal than what was presented the first time around, and it really meshes well with the selectmen's goals of trying to create life downtown. If we can get more people living and working downtown, it's going to support those ancillary businesses. Of course, it's also going to produce revenue where this project can go as a public building. So it's really a great effort that I'm looking forward to kind of seeing through to fruition. You know, we've done a lot of things to kind of help sort of create excitement down there. We expanded the 40R district so there can be more types of developments that will kind of each support each other. Through Julie and Jean's assistance, we got a much coveted grant for wayfinding and branding so that we can help, now that we've done some really good things, try to bring people to them and create that kind of excitement. So I'm really excited about this project. I think it's really going to anchor Haven Street. We've got a lot of new things coming. Think of it in Reading. Someone's building a bookstore right around the corner from where your development's going to be. So there's a lot of really fun and exciting things happening in town that your development is really going to help spearhead. I do have sort of one question and sort of one to kind of get your thoughts on this. As you know, part of, you know, this economic development stuff is creating the life downtown, and the one amenity that that you've proposed in here, obviously other than just kind of the development itself, was this courtyard that is now, it's on Sanborn Street, which is sort of off the beaten path a little bit, and it looks like it's sort of more of an amenity for the residential than it is a public amenity. So even from the renderings, it looked like if it was sort of an imposing thing. You have the entryway to the residential there. Do you envision any programming, any public use of that space, or do you envision that more as just sort of an amenity for the building? You know, I think it's a nice open area that could sort of, you know, be used for sort of a public amenity. Do you have any thoughts or programming for that
If I may, give an initial point, we're certainly open to suggestions. I think that the public is going to be welcome to use it. In fact, I have two benches in my front of my office where people come along all the time and sit and relax there, so they would not be precluded from that. It would be a welcoming environment.
Which is, I mean, that's just one thing that I would encourage, though, Mr. Chair, is that, you know, think through just sort of how that could be used as sort of a public space, not just for the benefit of the residential owners.
Well, I suspect, with nothing to back it up, that reawakening the stairs and the facade of the historic building is going to go a long way to bringing that back into the neighborhood, if you will, activate that area. I mean, right now it's just, you know, it's really, really pretty and dead.
That was also our reason for putting that small one-story addition down near the parking lot, and that does have a plaza right out in front of it to kind of have a little space.
Other comments? Yes.
Virginia Adams, associate member of the Reading Historical Commission. I'd like to call your attention that the commission did submit a letter to CPDC and in support of this project. Done. Now, as a personal opinion, I have great concerns about the fact that designing interrupts the granite walls in two places. Now, those granite walls are very give you a visual sense of the importance of this structure. And so perhaps you might want to consider how that will impact the overall use. Thank you.
Okay.
Historic on that, and we haven't really worked out the details by the one-story addition, but we're thinking to minimize that to not much more than the existing break in the wall that is there for the parking lot. So just enough to get a drive and a small passageway for people to get from the sidewalk into that courtyard. We do have some work to do on details of that, and we'll work with the Historic Commission on that.
I still think the sight lines are more important, so I'd rather not have a pedestrian get hit, somebody coming out of that entrance way, so
we'll balance that. We're well aware of how to balance that.
Okay. Other comments? Yes, sir.
John Halsey. I live on Beaver Road and from the Board of Selectmen. So there are two of us, so I guess we're not in trouble. I'd just like to comment on the fact that this presentation, first of all, I'd like to, as those members of the board complimented them, this was really kind of like the night at the movies. It was great. If you really like Reading, it was really exciting. And to kind of play off of what Barry Berman has said, the selectmen have looked in a visionary way towards economic development. And we've been working on this now for several years. And this is kind of the, in my opinion, a spectacular example of how that development comes. And, you know, it was good to hear about the actual revenues, I mean the direct revenues, both one time and ongoing, that come in. And I'm always, as a selectman who is facing the potential of override, love to hear positive revenue coming. So that's pretty exciting. But I think it's bigger than that, actually. And I've thought that since I began to hear about this project. And that is that it appears to me that a project like this, beyond what it does on its own footprint, kind of ties together to the thing that Mr. Berman talked about, the expansion of the 40R. The whole idea of the development of Haven Street into a bustling location. And the implication of that, as I said, is much grander than the site itself, even though the site is quite beautiful. I think the thing that I'm struck with is that this is in many ways a keystone project, the thing that kind of unlocks the opportunity that we have with a commuter rail and, you know, a very walkable downtown. I think it's going to be a strong encouragement beyond the obvious that we heard about for other projects to follow, because now suddenly you've got another 50 families that are able to walk to the Commerce, and it's going to encourage Commerce. I think that there's just so many kind of overriding connections to the things that we've worked at for selectmen towards the economic development, because at the end of the day, the more of this economic development that goes on, the less burden on the residential taxpayer. And those are kind of two things that we work hard on, and I think this project helps to address both of those.
Okay. You can't do anything with the roof of the old post office as far as an open deck or usable space?
We had, our original proposal obviously was building out onto that, and we do have some decks right in front of the old piece of it for those units that are right there. But we didn't really want to alter that piece of the historic structure.
Okay, so you can't use it for garden space.
I think it would be too impactful on the development, and I think Mass Historical and Reading would probably agree with that.
I mean, I do think that the Sanborn Courtyard, I've never thought of that as a public space. I think that people walking past it might see residents using it, and that's engaging enough, and potentially some interaction happens. But I've always thought of the Haven Street side as being the engaging part.
I think our vision for that courtyard is more kind of very pleasant landscape space to walk by, because it isn't pleasant walking from Woburn Street down to Haven on Sanborn right now.
Parking lots.
It's all parking lots on both sides of the street, et cetera. So I think that the idea of having the, and it also served well to help break up our facade along Sanborn too. So it kind of serves the purpose of a public amenity from a visual standpoint. Certainly it doesn't stop people from coming there, but I think, as you say, a lot of people would not necessarily wander up in there to do any activity. They may wander in there to look at flowers or look at the landscape.
So we're going to need to wait for to hear back from engineering anyways, right? Do we want to discuss anything else, like these some of these waivers? From the beginning, I know that we've always been discussing this waiver of the height. You know, we've been using the not the technical number, right, from the low side, but I always understand it to, because it helped write this, the zoning. I've always understand it as perceived height, and so to me, really, it's the height from Sanborn Street. When I'm standing on that corner, how tall that building is. So really, it's only about 5 feet higher than the 45 feet, right? Corner, and even then, you're still stepping it back at the third floor, and then the penthouse isn't even on that corner. So, I wouldn't have a problem from that side with the height. I understand that, you know, there's a slope on the other side, and if you did the math, you get this 15-foot waiver. But I really don't think that's what it is. And I do think that the building massing helps to address its size. It's as much as historic might have been a pain for the developer to deal with, I think they gave you a much better building. I think it's a much better project.
The process worked well.
Thoughts on that height waiver? I'm not making a decision, I'm just having a discussion.
Yeah, I'm in favor of pretty much whatever we need to get this done.
Well, I wouldn't phrase it that way, because I think that the height is still within the spirit of what we wrote.
I would agree. I guess the one place that it comes into question is that corner, that
back
up Sanborn, and
towards Linden.
Yeah, and I guess in support of that and making sure that we're comfortable with that, you know, you could put together, you know, doesn't necessarily need to be as fancy as what you did before. It can be whatever works, but having that that rendering that sort of puts the massing in perspective from that. From that area, I think would be helpful. For just putting that.
There's no abutters here. Residential abutter on Linden isn't here. I mean, that's the biggest impact to me. It's the house immediately after the Verizon building is already down, you know, a whole story, and then it has the whole building at its corner. I'm just surprised that person's not here. Or are they? And just not speaking. You do step it back several times in that corner, helps a little bit, but it's not going to hide the building. That was the biggest waiver I saw. What else was there?
Here, building height density to allow density of 52 units per acre.
I assume the town wants the 70% local
projects with that, so working with the state, we'll figure that out.
The off-street loading. Put my 2 cents in for that already.
It's true, but I think that discussion brought up the fact that that large curb cut goes away, and so you can make up the parking if you donate, if we're donating a piece of the street for that loading. It might actually work, because it might leave that, if it was immediately after the parking lot, then it would sort of
right
off sight lines and sort of open up the corner of the building. No, you wouldn't have a vehicle there all the time.
Right, right.
So it would kind of more attractive.
Yeah.
You're right. The parking could be closer to Haven Street. That's just my first thought on that. But you guys have to weigh in on what you think loading on that street would be like.
Yeah, we'll I think we're going to work with engineering on that.
Right.
Front yard setback is a waiver just because of the existing building.
Yeah.
And a residential is what I noted. It's actually to the residential zone that's in the middle of Sandborn Street.
Yeah. We're not far off though.
13 foot 4.
Yeah.
I believe we do comply with the setback, building setback now, with this smaller, reduced size building.
We talked a little bit about trees. I mean, I don't see any showstoppers there.
No.
So, if there's nothing else, we'll continue the hearing.
We'll move to
the next, like, open agenda is September 25th. But if you think that you're, if you're not asking for anything additional besides comments from my hearing, I think that this could be quick. I could try to squeeze it on the 11th. It'll just be late in the night. So.
I can't hear you.
Sorry.
September 11th, late. Or
September 25th early.
September
11th. Yeah, I'd be okay with it. I, like I said, it looks really good. It looks like giving us a good project.
Move that the CPDC continue the public hearing for the project at 136 Haven Street and 0 Sandborn Street, Postmark Square, until Monday.
It's probably going to be at least 9. Yeah, I'll do my best to get it.
Second.
Okay.
Thank you, Ray.
Thank you.
We appreciate that tonight.
Make sure you have some coffee that day.
We'll take care of it.
I'll bring it. Sure.
Yeah.
We're going to park for free. All right, so.
People come in whipping off.
We're going to go to the continued public hearing for Barton Estates.
Good evening.
Yeah.
Phil Christensen for the developer.
Oh.
As you know, we were here before with the definitive plan. We received some comments. As you remember, it was we were looking for a low impact design concept. We went back to talk with engineering about it, also with conservation, and also the comments, Mr. Chairman, that you sent in regarding curbing, you're concerned about the edge of the road if you didn't have curb, and then also how you could incorporate low impact design with that. So what we've done here is to maintain on the left side of the road, and as you know, we're building this on Franklin Street, which is 24 feet wide, has a sidewalk one side and doesn't have curbing. So what we have here now is a road that's 26 feet wide with curbing on both sides. Sidewalk one side, that's your standard detail, 5 foot sidewalk, 9 foot 6 foot planting strip, 6 inch curb, and then 26 feet of pavement. And on the other side, what we're doing is providing that swale for stormwater management. And to get the water into the swale, what we're doing is proposing that the curb extend 20 feet, and every 20 feet have a 2 foot opening to allow the water to flow through and get into the drainage swale that we show here. So this maintains the roadway cross section. The engineering was happy with 26 feet. They want to see the curbing all around the roadway. So we think we've dealt with that pretty well. And it still gives us the opportunity to do some low impact development design on one side of the roadway. Also in the design, engineering suggested that we could tie into the Franklin Street drainage. Julie, if you could maybe go to the site plan.
From your original submission?
No, no.
Oh, one up.
Just, yeah, up.
This?
Yeah, that's fine. So what we've proposed here is on this side of the street, this is where the drainage swale would be. It's a treatment swale, actually, with infiltration underground. And on this side of the street, where we have the sidewalk, we can't have the water running in that direction. The water runs onto the road. It'll come down, go into a catch basin here, infiltrate here, and that way we can get the required 80% removal of suspended solids as required by regulation. But then we'd have an overflow from this. In this manhole, we'd have a second, or the catch basin, we'd have a second outlet that ties into the town drainage system here. So we can get rid of the smaller storms than this, and then the larger storms if necessary overflow into the street drainage. And we're able to accomplish that by this road going uphill to this point. The planning board regulations, as you know, require the road to go downhill from here into a site. But at the suggestion of the engineering department to let some of the water go into the Franklin Street drainage system, the only way to accomplish that is to have this road come uphill slightly. So there's a 2% grade uphill to about 150 feet into the project, which is about here, and then it goes downhill in the back. And the water that comes off here will drain out through through these openings and the curbing, drain into the swale. This is all grass through here, and there'll be a beehive grade on top of the infiltration system. This is underground, this system right here, as this one is. And then the excess water will drain into that and then infiltrate into the ground. As we said early on, we did infiltration tests here, and the soil is extremely pervious, so we can get a high for rapid rate of infiltration. And then on the far end of the project, again, because there's curbing around here, we have to have, and the sidewalk as well, we have to have catch basins at this location, and we'll probably put infiltration detention area at the center. So we wanted to get your feedback regarding this roadway design, that cross-section we're proposing, and if that's acceptable to the board, then we'll go ahead and redo the plan with a detailed design that reflects all of the engineering information we need to provide.
Thoughts?
Well, from a water management point of view, it looks well designed. I'm curious about the pedestrian character, or whatever we would call it, access from the properties across the side of the road, which is has the swale. What does my front walk look like?
Your front walk is, that swale's only a foot deep from, you mean right in here, right?
Yeah, well, so, for the lot 4, 5, and 6.
Well,
no.
We have here 4 and 5. This is a curb all around to approximately this point.
Okay.
So 5 and 4, no problem. There's a sidewalk extends to this point. The only one you'd have, maybe, you'd look at this one and say, okay, there's a slight swale in front of this lot here. There's a driveway that goes over it, so the driveway provides you access right out to the street. And you do have access this way if you wanted to.
Okay.
And then, by the way, too, we'd have to have, this sidewalk walk would extend handicap access here, obviously, crosswalk marked, and build a handicap access on the other side on Franklin Street.
I guess to add for what it might look like, that swale area is 16 feet wide. So graded out, it's very shallow and gradual.
No, I understand.
It's going to look like your front yard. It's not going to look like crossing a canyon.
Okay.
It'll just potentially be wet and a high water line.
Right.
Yeah.
With the beehive catch basin, at some point it would overflow into the system if it was coming in too fast.
Do you have a culvert under the driveway? What's going to happen?
Yes, it'll be a small culvert.
Okay.
I asked, I mean, my front walk has been rebuilt 3 times because of drainage issues, so that's why I asked.
I think one of the things about the soil is, I mean, it's just all sand.
Yeah.
So it really, you know, you're not going to have those problems with frost breaking things down here, particularly because everything drains into the ground. So that's why it's good for this type of stormwater management.
Regarding the sidewalk, would it, does it make sense or really matter if you sort of, I'm going to say, had it go, what direction is that, west, and had the, instead of having the crosswalk in the middle of the curve, extend the sidewalk out so that it's after where cars are turning in and out, depending, of course, what's on the other side of the street. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, follow the curve around.
So instead of here and you build a longer sidewalk, I mean, crosswalk here, whether you just curve, you know, you have this little here and then put the crosswalk.
I could cut down the curve on the road, make it a bit tighter so I could fit it in there. Yeah, we can do that.
We did have a question on that when it comes to your rules of the reg, so is the town glued to the sidewalk being that far off the roadway? I think it's 9'6". The regs call for 10 feet. And then the trees, I assume, go in that area.
Tree line dimension.
But we've been doing a lot of 4-foot grass strip, 4-foot sidewalk, which still leaves you 6 feet of right-of-way, and putting the trees in the backside of right-of-way closer to the property line.
You'd have to negotiate that with the town engineer.
So it's not a planning board issue.
Talk to him first. But it is ultimately your decision.
Right now, the plan is to put the trees in the tree lawn proper, so between the sidewalk and the...
On the, where the sidewalk is, yes. The other property, we would put them on the trees, the street trees would be on the lots themselves, on lots 5 and 6.
I like the configuration better, having, like you said, a smaller lawn, a 4-foot lawn, grassed, sidewalk, and then trees on the backside. I think from a longevity standpoint, that ends up being better for the trees and better for the sidewalks as the root balls come up. And
a lot of towns are doing that.
Yeah, I think that ends up being better, but we've never had that discussion or feedback from engineering at all. So I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I guess as Julie said, you can talk with the town engineer, but it sounds like we're on board.
Yeah.
Lawn.
And then the trees are on the
other side.
Yes.
Yeah.
Side.
Yeah.
I mean, that's how my street was built back in the mid-'80s. So.
I'm meeting with Ryan tomorrow to talk about something.
Okay.
Yeah. There's a reason why it's better the other way.
The only other question I have is the overflow from the smaller infiltration chamber is below grade.
Yes. Yes, it's
piping
what we'd have is two pipes in the catch basin. So the lower one would go to the infiltration chamber, and if it gets overloaded, then the pipe just fills up and flows out the other one to the street drainage.
Okay.
Kind of simple, but...
All right, we're not sending water off the street onto
no.
Franklin. Right.
And there was a catch basin there. That's why it happened to work out that way.
One of the other things here was the fire department likes the center of the cul-de-sac paved, so we get rid of the island that we had there. We're trying to get some indication from engineering about where the snow is going to go, because regardless of what we say, it's up to whoever DPW hires to do the plowing. So, around the cul-de-sac, that's just going to be pushed out in that grass area there between the sidewalk and the cul-de-sac. I think that front corner where the driveway is, where the sidewalk is, will be, that's a little trickier where the snow is going to go, because they're going to plow it up on the sidewalk initially. This isn't where you want it, so that's something we'll have to designate, but whether anybody follows through on it is a whole different issue.
Well, do we have a list of places where it can't go then as part of the subdivision?
Yeah. We'll put some snow areas on there.
Well, I'm saying the opposite. I'm saying where it shouldn't be.
Where it should, well, we could do that, yeah.
Fade from the swales. We should go on the swales.
Town engineer didn't comment on that at all?
On what?
On the snow removal.
Getting rid of the... putting pavement in the cul-de-sac was something that DPW had kind of brought up, that trying to plow that with having the opening in the middle would have been very difficult, so that was one of the things. In general, they pushed the snow in the cul-de-sac to the far end.
Yeah, that's really not the way we should be planning our subdivisions, by the way.
Say that again?
Oftentimes we want this little center island. It's pervious, it breaks up the hot asphalt, it looks better. And now we're just basing it on, so that 3 months out of the year, DPW can plow it easier.
And
the fire department.
Well, I understand their laydowns. They want to have room to operate if there's an issue, but, you know, it could be pervious pavement or something. It could be something flat that you could still break up somehow. I don't know. We'll have to think about that one in the future.
Yeah.
You know. Anything else from staff or board? Commission?
No. Board. Commission.
Anything from the public?
I'm Nancy Cole. I live on the corner of Franklin and Pearl Street. And so this will be a subdivision just about 3-4 doors down on my side of the street. And I have my main concern that I want to address tonight is still traffic on Franklin Street. And I asked the police department to run a study to give me I requested, and they redacted, of course, confidential information, and the number of accidents between Haverhill and Maine on Franklin from August 15th of 2016 through August 15th, 2017, there were 14 accidents. I'm trying to gather some other information, and my concern, is adding 6 more houses that are going to be accessing on that side of the street. We have the 3 other cul-de-sac subdivisions that are all on the other side, along with the cemetery, but this will be the first group of houses that are going to be having access on that side of the street, and right now the traffic is bad and it's getting worse. Now I ask for a second report from the police department for any other two-lane road in a residential area to do a comparison, and of course there's really not one, and they told me to pick out any other road, but there's not another that I know of two-lane road residential area where we could get a comparison, because I didn't want to just choose, this area and not have a comparison. So some of you may know of one that I don't know of, but my understanding is this is the only road that crosses all the way across. And we also have semis that go up and down. We have a lot of foot traffic, bicycle traffic.
Walkers, runners.
Lots, people pushing baby buggies, all sorts of things. So I'm just concerned that we pay attention to the sight lines and any additional traffic, including, of course, where snow can't go, because my front yard or backyard ends up being where we have to put snow, I suppose, when we have too much, and you can't, when you pull up on Pearl and want to get out on Franklin, you take your life in your hands like the winter of 2015 because you can't see around it. And so we don't need another such thing. So those are my big issues. It's
yeah, Will Finch, 51 Mill Street. I like the attempt to integrate low impact features in this development. I had, on other issues, one out of 364 Lowell Street, I was suggesting something like brakes in the curbs. I had also suggested sloped curbs to allow critters to get out of the road more easily. But if you've got these brakes in the sidewalk, that should help. Can the plowed snow go into the swale area? I mean, it actually be desirable to treat snow that's been plowed. Has this come up before?
I thought there was an issue about if the snow starts to then melt and freeze, then you're preventing the rest of the water from infiltrating. But what was the final say on that?
Well, I think that's what engineering says. My experience is that snow starts to melt from the bottom, and anytime you get melting, If say there's water coming off the road, it'll go right under the snow. That's what I've seen in a lot of places. So
yeah, I don't think so too.
some snow can go there, but you certainly can't have six foot mound and a 16 foot wide swale.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So my other question was, I know in talking with Chuck Tarone in conservation, there was some talk of a connection of a trail easement from this property through to Eastway. I know there's some property issues with the homeowner over on Eastway. Do you have any updates on that?
I thought we talked about that, and that you'd be crossing over private property. There's no way to provide access, right? Isn't that what came up last time?
Yeah, it's a small piece. It would just be a small piece, and I guess that ship sailed. So even though they are giving that property owner some land, their existing driveway, the ship has sailed on getting something in return. Is that correct?
Our understanding is, there wasn't anyone really interested in that connection from that side of the street. Not that we'd be opposed, but if the neighborhood doesn't want it, we certainly don't want to force it.
Anyone else? Okay. So where do we stand? Do we have something we can approve, or are we still
not
waiting?
Yet.
So,
we still need to go to conservation. When does that?
We opened last week.
Okay.
Now we have to revise all the plans.
Well, I mean, I appreciate the effort to combine some of these things in there. And I don't know if you saw that email that I sent. I think we can
do a lot.
Yes,
that's why we incorporated the curb into everything.
Yeah, we can do a lot more with not building all that traditional infrastructure. If we're going to do low-impact development, then let's do a low-impact development. Let's just make sure our road doesn't collapse.
Yeah.
Figure out a way.
If I can go back to the connection, the easement, the potential for one. It had come up before you were proposing it, understanding that it can't really be used or exercised at the moment because the property owners on Eastway have no interest in it. That doesn't necessarily mean that 30, 40 years down the line, that won't change. I don't know where you stood on that, whether you're going to provide it, even though it doesn't provide any benefit in the, I'm going to call it the near term, the next 10 or 15 years, or is it just completely off the table?
I would hate to provide an easement to nowhere, open to the public, if it doesn't have a connection.
Attractive nuisance.
Yeah.
So that's come up in our discussion. So we're concerned, you know, down the road, someone just hang out there. We couldn't actually go anywhere. Mm-hmm. I get what you're saying, and it could work out down the road, but we also don't want to cause a problem. And some of the neighbors specifically brought up that they don't want people hanging out in the woods.
Position was if the town could get the easement the east way, we'd provide the easement during the process, and if that can't be done, then.
And even if it doesn't happen, if there was a condition in the approval that, you know, prior to the last occupancy, prior to occupancy of that unit, if it came back, we deal with it. But at some point, we're going to deed these properties off. And
just in the sense that, you know, we, right, there's cul-de-sacs all over the place, and there's always going to be cul-de-sacs. It's not a great thing. The way that we, as a planner, we want to make sure there's as much connectivity as we possibly can. This is one way that it could be made. I know in the subdivision regs there are some guidance to try and provide connections where it is possible. That's all auto-oriented. And hopefully, you know, we're in a post-auto focused world here, which is why I'm just trying to imagine a way that that could be done, not for the way that we live now, but for the, you know, for something that may change in the future. So I don't have I'm not directing you to do anything, but I'm sort of throwing that more in Julie's court to see if, or someone in the town's court, that see if the understanding, I get the idea of, you know, providing an easement to nowhere makes no sense, but maybe there's an easement that can only be exercised at a certain time or something. You just don't want us to be short-sighted.
No.
We'll see if we can, maybe even if we could draft something up that says that, that it can't be exercised until it's in.
It's connected through, yeah.
That might, but we don't, we'll have to run it by some attorneys.
Yeah, right, it truly comes up with.
Yeah, in this particular case, I mean, the blockage is small.
Yep.
It's a short portion at the end of that lot line, so.
I have sort of another comment, taking off the CPDC hat, as a Pearl Street resident. It'd be great to have some landscaping and a little bit of cleanup happening over there, particularly in the house that's still occupied. There's no reason for that property to look like that. We really would like some good neighbors and good stewards on that street.
It's also required by the town's vacant properties by law.
It's not vacant.
It's not vacant.
Talk about the occupied property.
Your concern is mostly with the one that's occupied.
Yeah, I'm really the one talking about. I mean, you really can't do anything about the lot you ripped up.
So we're gonna.
Yeah, I'm just not sure. We were just discussing 4854 Franklin Street. Did you have public comments? You came in late?
No.
Okay. Just wasn't sure whether we were here. All right, let's continue it then.
Yeah, so when do you think he'll. Our next available agenda is September 25th.
When would plans have to be done?
Well, I mean, I'm hoping for approval. Engineering usually needs 3 to 4 weeks. They're understaffed. I mean, and they're so swamped. So I just have to be, you know, cognizant of that. Not hoping for approval at the next meeting, then, you know, a week or two is fine.
Let's hope.
Why would you come then? You know, we're probably just that one step away from engineering looking at it and not having any comments.
Right.
Yeah, we haven't already met with Ryan. I think we're
hoping
to be on the same page with everybody. So maybe if he doesn't expedite it.
Can we be on the agenda?
On the 25th.
Yeah. We'll try to.
I mean, maybe he'll be quicker. I just want to be fair. September 25th.
Move that the CPDC continue the public hearing for the definitive subdivision plan at 4854 Franklin Street until Monday, September 25th at 9 o'clock.
This one's going to be 7:30.
Yeah. Okay.
All right.
Nothing
Thank
else
you.
On that agenda yet.
Second.
All in favor? Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Some public hearing for some rules and regulations on site plan review, minor site plan review, and stormwater management control.
So, what's interesting about this is that it hasn't changed since you looked at it in April.
Okay.
And I didn't think a public hearing was necessary, and then I came aware of the general bylaw requirement for public hearing for rules and regulations. So I posted it and everything, sent it to town council, and he said, "You're not subject to this." Already posted, so here we are. So nothing's changed. I have no feedback from town council because they didn't weigh in, and they're not even convinced that the CPDC is subject to that.
Okay.
So
we don't have to read this public notice, or
maybe
we move to
are
forego reading the public
for this?
Notice.
Is it 1268? No, yours are, your plans already got endorsed. Yeah.
Okay.
John was here.
Okay, good. Thank you. Good. We were on it.
That was all we wanted anyway.
Yeah, no, I usually have them take up the small stuff like that at the beginning, and I told John that.
Sorry.
Thank you. No, you're fine.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay. So.
So.
Nothing has changed.
Nothing has changed, no.
But I wish I could remember where we left off. I think we should review each one of these in detail.
Yeah.
Tony, did you see anything wrong with these?
not had a chance to review them.
Yeah.
Had plenty of time to have them changed.
Yeah. Are you going to read the legal ad just in case?
Yeah,
like,
let's do that. Let's
emails
go
through
the
rest. And says, oops.
Notice is hereby given that pursuant to section 4.6.1.2 of the Town of Reading Zoning Bylaw and perhaps section 5.3 of the Town of Reading General Bylaws, the Community Planning and Development Commission will hold a public hearing on Monday, August 28, 2017 at 8:45 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Reading Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, to consider the adoption of revised site plan review procedures and minor site plan review procedures, and to consider the adoption of stormwater management and erosion control procedures and regulations. A copy of the proposed procedures and regulations is available to the public in the Public Services Department in Town Hall on Monday, Wednesday, and Thursday from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. and on Tuesday from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m.
Thank you. So we already voted on this.
Yep. But you can vote again just to make it official, extra cautious.
Okay. So, any public comments? All right.
Move that the CPDC adopt the regulations as presented.
Second.
All in favor? What else do you have for us?
Isn't that enough? We have plans on your seat for 24 Gold Street, which is coming on the 11th. It's another 40-yard development. There's a site visit on Wednesday. Just thought it was appropriate to invite you since they were had it with the Reading Historical Commission.
Just gonna walk it and listen to them, right? You said no sustained
no deliberations.
No discussions.
I mean, I have posted you guys, but
they can't accidentally knock down the other building that's on the corner. Okay.
It's not especially since you said it on TV.
Oh, please. Have we forgotten how to be sarcastic? Okay, so nothing is ahead of us yet until on this thing.
What do you mean nothing is ahead of you?
We have a site plan and we can't discuss anything. When are they scheduled to come in?
For 24 Gold Street?
Yeah.
November 11th.
Okay.
Yeah. That's just, I just gave it to you so you can look at it before.
I understand. Time. That's fine.
Yeah.
But they're on the agenda. That's
they
it.
Are.
Okay.
There's also another 4-unit residential 40R at 14 Chapin that's been filed as of Thursday. It's on the east side of Main Street. Do you remember the discussion of that property at the top of Ordway Terrace? And then when we were talking about the downtown Smart Growth District like expansion,
yeah.
It looked like it cut through.
Right.
This is the one that's, it wasn't cutting through a property, but it looked like it was.
Okay.
This property is in the district.
So we think that these developers were just kind of waiting around for us to expand the district and had some projects in mind. It looks like there's some activity going on.
I think some of it was Kismet. They were looking at properties around the same time, at least with Mark. With 14 Chapin, it's the property owner.
Yeah, and that's a
small. I don't know if he was.
Might have gotten encouraged by when you had the public discussions earlier.
Yeah, I mean, this is what this was intended to do, so.
Right.
Yep. Definitely a much more collaborative and friendly approach to doing these things.
Then the other state statute.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. It's a mess.
Yeah.
Okay.
I agree. So.
And you got my, we had a discussion that
yes.
Reading Village. They started digging a test pit and they just left it unprotected. Started digging it without a permit as well.
How deep was it?
It's about 7 or 8 feet deep, at least, from what you could see from the road. And all they did was put some snow fence around it, and that had collapsed into the hole. You know, there's no fence. It's on right on the Brown's property, so it's ungated. The old Brown.
Yeah, that's not good.
Right.
Having fallen into a drainage pit myself one time.
Really?
That's not good.
Yeah, so I quickly looked through the decision, and I didn't see the Jackie's Law mention in it. Like, we used to have in our decisions. I'm not sure if we still continue to write that.
Jackie's Law is automatic.
Oh, it's definitely, it doesn't matter. You have to comply with it, of course. But it's sort of like a you know, smacking them in the head and saying, don't forget this. And then the first thing they do is forget that.
Right. Well, they didn't pull a permit from engineering, so.
I understand.
There you go. Yep. We are on it. So.
Okay, great. Still unprotected.
Well.
Okay.
Engineering was on it. There's a few other things that are on as well. So.
Sure.
That have recently been brought to our attention.
Yes, sir.
Tony Durazzo, 130 John Street. With the soon-to-be approval of the Postmark Square and some of these other projects that have been referenced, do we know where the town stands with our, roughly with the 40B at this point?
Can you be more specific?
We're currently in safe haven.
We are currently safe haven for up until, I want to say, February of next year.
That's correct.
I believe that we were 8 or 9 units away from being safe haven for another year after that.
28 units. We're 28 units shy of a second year.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we're getting there very
quickly. Does that include
quickly.
The units?
It will,
from,
yes.
So Postmark Square plus 28? Or
no, sorry, 28. So we have 68 on the record. For Reading Village. We need 28 more to be good for 2 years. So this project will give us 10. We have a few other projects that are coming, like E-Mark project. That number of affordable units is not entirely certain, but I think the whole project will count. So we think we might get there.
Okay.
Yeah.
Here. And we're obviously paying attention to both the unit count and the production rate.
I forgot to mention Schoolhouse Commons added 20, so we're actually very
close.
The
unit count only matters every 10 years.
Mm.
The unit count doesn't change until the
census
updates it.
But we should always be aware of
it. We should be aware of it, yes.
Right.
But as we add new units in that aren't affordable, our unit count doesn't go up. It's a game. It's crazy math. But it's the way it works.
Think about tracking it any other way.
Yes.
Forget it.
Yeah.
So we're actually very close, and Gina and I are on top of that. It'll still, I should clarify though, that even if we do get a 2 year safe harbor, it's still up to the zoning board to decide whether they want to entertain the hearing or not for a 40B. So there'll be other conversations that will have to be had if we're at that point. We'll try to be strategic about it so that we don't completely overwork ourselves and the public with these projects, but it's to be determined.
Thank you.
Another thing that just wondering if it's coming up is with a couple of different developments happening downtown. As predicted, parking is going to be a bigger issue, not driven by any one particular project, but just in general. And that's not necessarily an issue that this board can lead
parking,
but one that certainly impacts the livability. And so just wondering if that's on the agenda for anyone to tackle, to advance, not tackle.
Exactly.
No one's going to tackle.
What are you looking for? What are you looking for?
Well, we hired a consultant when was that? I'm going to say, yeah, close to 10 years ago.
Right.
Came up with some good ideas that weren't necessarily implementable. And whether there's other, maybe dusting off some of their ideas or other ideas, other ways to manage parking that
we reached out to them to do an update for us, and it's not money that we have right now.
Yeah.
That's the tricky thing is the plan.
I guess I'm not necessarily advocating bringing them back in, but just a discussion on, I mean, there's a lot of smart people in town, a discussion on different ways to manage and address parking. Because it's going to, with these two developments right here, it's going to start to...
Yeah, no, it's more. Something that we talk about all the time, and we are trying to figure out a way to cost-effectively address some of the concerns downtown. We thought we might be able to have a chief to come back and kind of give us, like, because it's 2009 was, you know, 8 years ago, and things have changed. And we're still, even if we were to implement some of the things they suggested, we still need the upfront capital to do that. So there's some, yes, we have the expertise in town. Gene and I could, we just need the time.
Yeah.
And money. So.
Okay. The other thing, has there been much activity at all on pedestrian connectivity? Because we've had the discussion about the whatever the street names are, Ash Street, Washington Street, Grade Crossing, you're basically getting from one side of Main Street to the other is still taking your life in your hands, even though the traffic lights are much better than they were. Is that anything in progress, or is that just a...
talking about like roadway diet project, or like
roadway
safety
diet,
audit, or
but there was discussion about the foot of Minot Street, the signaled pedestrian interchange or crosswalk there. I mean, some amount of discussions with Pizza World, I guess, was the old Getty Station project was on the plate, and Perfecto's, which is looking more and more complete, but not yet open. I'm just wondering if there had been any thoughts, activity focusing on that stretch of Main Street.
Not recently, to my knowledge, but potentially 306 Main Street may be coming up.
Okay.
Maybe that discussion can
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. So I know some time ago we potentially discussed, I'm not sure how to phrase this properly, developer participation in some of the town's goals to fund certain projects. So I forget who was supposed to be possibly doing some research into that. I'm making this stuff.
You mean like when they have a project before the board? Ask them to help us do things?
Like community space?
I mean, every time we have a project, we try to get something. But random developers aren't just going to like give the town a bunch of money.
No. Obviously, ones that have projects ongoing that have been approved.
If there's something in a decision, then we hold them to it, yes. And then they're before you write the decision, we try to negotiate.
We try to integrate the project into the community. We're not trying to extort them.
Right, you know, exactly.
Build a ball field over here because you're putting in four units over there. It's more about
more like Virginia exaction type of stuff, which would be great if we could do, but we can't.
We can't.
We're not allowed to. It's got to be, it's got to be
connected.
Yeah,
it has to be something reasonable. You know, granted, if people were breaking down the door to build something in the downtown to fill the stores, then we'd have a little more leverage. But right now, we're just starting to churn this new smart growth, and it looks like people are interested in it again. Get some projects going, we'll see what happens. Let's see what happens with these two that are already on the boards, and then see what happens with the Gould Street.
Mm-hmm.
Getting there. So moving.
Yep.
Tony DeRosa, 130 John Street. They won't have to keep saying that. But I also brought up earlier this year about subdivisions that are now going to push the unit count up for the 40Bs and maybe extracting some sort of in-kind payment or a payment towards the affordable housing fund.
Yeah, we did talk about that earlier. That's something we should consider when it's over a certain number, because it's right, it's just driving the number.
Yeah.
Right. Could add some language in the subdivision regulations. If you guys decide you want to take that on, it's something to update.
I think it's worth thinking about, because if we can reduce, if we start looking at this low-impact development stuff, that reduces the cost to the contractor. Rather than throwing that back into their pocket, if we throw that into the, you know, affordable housing fund or some other open space thing, actually, the CPA kind of thing,
yeah, right.
We never did, that's probably more valuable than building a bunch of pipes under the ground.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because that 6-unit subdivision, we're going to just look up Haverhill Street. I mean, that's what we're going to end up with marching up Haverhill Street. It'd be like 3-unit subdivisions. It's called exactly.
Until you sort of quell people's desire for that, people still want that.
Yeah.
They don't care that they can't cut through the neighborhood. You used to when you were a kid.
I'm not saying good or bad. I'm just, that's how, that's going to continue to happen. And we should be.
Yeah, we should think about that.
We should think about how that, what that means and what our.
Figure out what the trade-off.
Yeah.
When we write these rules, let's figure out what the trade-off.
Yeah.
But the other thing that this discussion brought to mind was the possibility of affordable housing over behind Salem 5. Across from 128 Marketplace, has there been continued movement on that? Or
to my knowledge, they don't have their project eligibility letter from the state yet. But typically after that, it's a pretty quick process with them filing with the town. So I'm just like waiting for it.
Yeah,
and that's one we could decide whether we took on or not.
Right. I mean, either open it now or wait till February, or wait till February 2019 if we get a 2-year safe harbor. Yep.
Okay.
I believe that was the impetus behind Tony's shinning.
It could be.
But I surmise.